Good evening, everyone. My name is Professor Tara Dean, and for those of you who don't know me, I'm the Provost at London South Bank University. It's my absolute pleasure to welcome you all to the inaugural lecture of Professor Steve Dunn. The presentation of inaugural lecture is a significant milestone in the academic career of a full professor. The inaugural lecture provides them an opportunity to present their career so far, to introduce their field of expertise to wider audience, and I understand the Steve has got some audience participation, so be prepared for that, and to update colleagues on current and future plans. For the schools where our professors are based, the event is a chance to celebrate their achievement across the staff and student body, to strengthen existing relations and catch up with some of our alumni, and of course to establish new collaboration and conversation. For the university, inaugural lecture represents really an essential component of the public events, as they are an extremely good opportunity to engage with the general public, creating a wider awareness of the university's contribution in terms of teaching and research. As such, we are really delighted to have kick-started these inaugural lectures again in person after the COVID pandemic. Meeting in person feels rather special, those little rituals, oh, come in, come in. Better late than never, as they say. Meeting in person really facilitates a greater richness of understanding, a greater flexibility of discussion, particularly after the lecture in the post-event reception, and a greater gravity generally for such an important milestone. Of course, meeting in person gives me the chance to rehearse that age-old tradition to any face-to-face meetings. I'm sure many of you miss those, so here it goes. Please switch off your mobile phones. Keep in mind that we are recording the event, the toilets are just outside, and we are not having a fire test. So if the fire alarm goes, please make your exit in an orderly fashion through that door. So that's it. Happy to have heard that again. So allow me to introduce Professor Dunn. He studied chemistry as an undergraduate at the University of Edinburgh. Then he went to Cambridge to do his PhD, where he was also a Cambridge Blue in Roy.
Sailing.
Sailing. Oh, I was given the wrong information. Okay. Is it the same thing? It involves water, so. Anyway, it's being a Cambridge Blue, what it really is, it's an award earned by sportsmen or sportswomen who, whilst at the university, compete in the highest level of sporting competition with outstanding sporting achievement. So that was really impressive. That impressed me even if I got the wrong score. He's one of relatively rare examples of academic researchers having worked both at academia, at Cranfield, at Queen Mary, and of course now at London South Bank University, as well as in industry, and I need to be able to pronounce this, you need to maybe be helping me. Is it Dere Galera? Oh, very good, limited. It's some company in Wales somewhere. Apparently it focuses on material science. And after that, more recently, before joining us, he was the director of SRD Scientific. So he returned to academia in 2019, joining us as head of chemical and energy engineering and professor of material engineering, materials engineering. His current interests concentrate on understanding and engineering functional metal oxide hybrid systems to enhance the surface chemistry in catalytic activity with application ranging from energy conversion to enhanced chemical processing rates and selectivity. I'm sure I'm given this sort of information to be tested, whether I can actually read all of this. That impressed me. But what really impressed me more is that he has around 120 peer-reviewed publications, and many of them are in high-impact journals like Advanced Materials and Energy and Environmental Sciences. He has a current H index of 41, which for me was extremely impressive, and probably the highest, one of the highest in LSBU. I would say amongst the highest in LSBU. And he has around 6,500 citations. He has supervised 23 PhD students to completion, and he has supervised over 200 third-year project and MSc students. So a phenomenal record of growing the next generation of academic researchers. His work has been funded by RCUK, Innovate UK, and industrial collaboration, such as Samsung and Bosch. Those are I wasn't given that, missing from, and Electrolux. With a total career research income that exceeds 10 million since 2003. So he will be any provost's favorite academic researcher with that sort of track record. A very accomplished researcher and educator. But what can I tell you about Steve as a person outside of his academic achievement and esteem measures? Very briefly, Steve is a cycling fanatic. Is that correct?
Yes.
Excellent. I won't mention that I was told you often have arrived rather bashed up with your bike, you know, involved in some sort of accident. But apparently you are a cycling fanatic and considerable enthusiasm for sailing. And what really got me going, that he loves chilies, so that we have in common. I am surprised I haven't seen you in one of the many national chili festivals around the country, which I love to attend. But what really intrigued me, and this is something that his dean shared with me, that he has ambition to open up and run a brewery out of his division at London South Bank University.
This is awesome.
I think it could be a genuine link to chemical engineering and educating our students within this. I will be certainly watching that development from afar. But seriously, he is a great colleague and an inspiration for his discipline, for students and staff. And we are extremely proud that he has chosen London South Bank University to be his academic home. So please join me in welcoming Professor Dunn to deliver his inaugural lecture.
That's incredibly flattering, and I've been asked all day if I feel nervous. I do now. I normally banter on for hours, but I do feel quite nervous. Thank you so much for coming. I realise it's an evening, and I hope that the next hour is entertaining. You've heard there will be dancing, so when the music comes on, you need to listen to it because it's going to be played twice. And I'm just going to have a little wander through what I've been doing with work for the last 20 years, and I actually looked at, when I was doing this, I looked at a paper I published, and it was 20 years ago, and it was a bit kind of shocking that I've been doing this for 20 years. But anyway, here we are. So, the title of the talk is From Pyro From Fire to Pyro, Sustainable Energy Through Materials Engineering. I've taken some photos. I didn't realise this was going to be recorded and gone public, so a lot of the stuff I've stolen off the web, including the music, so please don't copyright me. It's all there. But one of the things that someone pointed out to me when I first got the date for this was today is May the 4th. Going. That's not the music you're going to dance to later. It's much more Beethoven and AC/DC for those of you. So apparently my pictures are too big for the HDMI link. So what I've done for the last 20 years, and the guys and girls who have helped in the lab, have basically been playing with boring white powders and trying to make them do something exciting. So ceramics, metal oxides, and as Tara aptly described, they're functional. The stuff that we work with does something interesting. Now, we've got the marvel pyro guy there. One of the things we've been doing most recently is trying to use waste heat to do something interesting. So scavenge waste heat and do chemistry. And the chemistry we can do, and increasingly the chemistry we can do, really makes me feel quite excited. It's really good fun. We can take water and we can produce hydrogen. We can take carbon dioxide from the air and we can form fuels just by using waste. And that's quite neat, because actually the world has spent a long time digging stuff out of the ground and burning it. And all of the stuff around us that we rely on to live is a net result of that. And our lives are much enhanced because of it, but our kids and our kids' kids might be suffering because of that. So finding alternatives is something that does genuinely make me excited. And I'm quite excitable, you might notice. But this is where we've come from, the Carnot equation. The mechanical engineers will know this very well. Basically, something's hot, something's cold, you can do energy between those two surfaces. And that's how a car engine works. It's how all sorts of things, your boiler in your house makes hot water, the Carnot efficiency and Carnot systems. So the next thing is friends. When I was thinking about this and what this kind of talk is all about, I started to get quite emotional, because actually I'm standing here talking to you, but I am just a tiny little part of the success. Like Matt and Guru are in the lab in here now, and then we've got Suela's team in as well. And all the people in here, I'm here talking about the stuff that all these people did. And these are my friends, collaborators, these are people from all around the world that have basically supported me to achieve and do this. And it should never be forgotten that those people have worked their bums off. And we've had some great fun. We really have. We've had some absolutely wicked times along the way. We've had some hard times, because doing a PhD in research can be really soul-destroying. But basically, we've had a lot of fun. And the next bit is fun. So I have been massively fortunate. I have been around the world. I have been to places in the world I didn't even know existed when I was a wee boy. I have had Singapore crab in Singapore. I don't like the red stuff, like the black pepper crab. It's much nicer. I've had burgers in America. I've had Miley Cyrus talk about my work on BBC radio. She doesn't know anything about solar cells. We will come to that. But it was in the Mail online. I think and hope is the only time my work gets mentioned in the Mail. It's not really my go-to thing. And also it was published in the Netherlands. So a friend of mine who unfortunately died of COVID, I was really sad, he sent me this little link on WhatsApp to say that my work had made the press in the Netherlands. So we've had a wonderful time going around the world and just enjoying ourselves and doing science and engineering. So Tara kind of summed everything up in a little bit of a thing. So that's me as a wee boy. I don't think my face has changed that much. I'm still fundamentally a grumpy sod. But I've been really fortunate. I had the most wonderful education. So I grew up just north of Edinburgh. Love Edinburgh to bits, although I would never move back. It's too cold and dark. Had the best opportunity ever to go to Cambridge. And never as a kid, growing up in a little village in Scotland, thought I'd get to go to Cambridge. Through luck and just being in the right place at the right time and convincing someone that I would do a PhD well, I didn't really know I would, I got to go, and I had an amazing, in fact, we went, my mum, who's here today, and Rachel, we went punting on Monday in Cambridge. It was wonderful to go down the river again and just relive being in Cambridge. Then I went to Cranfield, the only university I know of that in the how to get there instructions tells you what runway to use and what frequency to land on. And I'm not lying. It does. The aircraft are there. They do have a runway. My boss, when I was there, got his PPL, private pilot's license. He was the last person who, when they joined Cranfield, to get it basically for free. The rest of us had to pay for it. That was a bit disappointing. And then QM, had 10 great years at QM, left QM to go to Derigellera, and Heju and the people there, I still love to go and visit, and we have some amazing time and do some really, really great fun science. And in fact, no ASIC from QM as well, so that's the Queen's Building at QM. So we've had some really, really good stuff. So what have I learned? I've learned that serendipity is your friend. Anybody who does research, who hasn't laid there in bed thinking, why on earth did I submit that proposal, because I haven't got a clue, is just basically telling you a bit of a fib. The only paper I ever published, and Tara's pointed out, published quite a few, I published one paper out of all of those that we worked out what the results would be before we wrote it. And we did the work, and we published it. 119 are just complete guesswork. And that comes back to the friends and the people in the lab working it all out for you, going through all the hard work. I remember, and we'll see her later on, Nimra comes up, she won a prize, she's a brilliant, brilliant lady. She spent almost 2 years trying to make something in the lab, unsuccessfully, and then just at the end of her second year of a PhD, she came running into my office, and it'll mean nothing to everybody, but it was basically a cloudy piece of glass. And that cloudy piece of glass was 2 years worth of work, and she managed to make it. And we worked so hard, and I have no idea how she had the energy to do it, because it was just failure after failure after failure. Anyway, she got a prize, she got a great job, she now works for Jaguar Land Rover, and is a really, really, really brilliant young lady. But serendipity is your friend, it really is. The other thing I've learned is that people are important, right? They're important in everything you do. We've got some people in here who know that I like to go for beer after work, we've got people in here who I will rely on to help me with my research when it's going really hard. I've got people in here I rely on just to get through the day sometimes. So people are really important. They will make your research work. As I said, I'm here because of the people around me, and I've been really fortunate. I have worked with some absolutely outstanding and brilliant people, really clever. And you know, you meet a clever person, you start talking, oh, and they're really clever and they motivate you to do stuff. So serendipity. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the work we did that is serendipitous. So it was completely fluke, completely random, really no idea it would go on. So this is some of my students back at QM days. They've all got jobs and have grown up now. But they're in Pisa against a leaning tower. So a leaning tower is falling over basically because of subsidence in Pisa. But one thing you should never do is take a photograph of your face and cut it in half, because we're all really asymmetric. We're not symmetrical. And it's quite disturbing when you look at your face superimposed. Internet, I stole this. So this is a face of someone. And the world, our world, is all about asymmetry. There is pretty much nothing in the natural world which is symmetrical. Everything is asymmetrical. And pretty much everything we rely on to get through the day relies on asymmetry. So your mobile phone that wakes you up in the morning, asymmetry in that. Everything is asymmetric. And things don't often do what you want them to do. Things will often do something completely random. So when I was a chemist, as a kid, we were told A plus B goes to blah, 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 different molecules. It doesn't. That's a complete lie. You might get A plus B plus a little bit of AB and a lot of other stuff. And one of the real challenges is that chemistry in the real world goes backwards and forwards. So a chemist, a material scientist, a chemical engineer is all about trying to drive things to force products. It's trying to move things in a direction you want them to go. Unfortunately, the world is always trying to push back. But we discovered 20 years ago that you could do something really quite neat. So what we've got is basically a ceramic. It's a very boring thing. It looks a bit brown. But we could pattern it using a microscope at incredibly small fidelity. So your hair is about 20,000 microns across. So we've got a scale bar here which is half the width of your hair. So we're drawing patterns on this ceramic that we could draw on someone's hair quite easily. And then we're actually able, and this is where the serendipity was, we're able to do chemistry where we wanted it to happen. So we've said, I want chemistry to happen there, not there, and we made it happen there. And that was quite a it's quite an unusual statement to make, that we can actually make chemistry happen somewhere predetermined by patterning a surface. So we could do that, and this is a nice little paper we did. Chi, who is now in Barcelona, he's really lovely, great guy. And it's the team across with Dawn Bunnell across in Penn State in America. So we did that 20 years ago. And then I kind of thought, well, how far can we go? That's cool, but what can we do? So then we started to make ridiculously fine patterns. So this is basically us depositing silver nanoparticles. So these lumps of silver, they're just silver nanoparticles, across an interface that we've drawn on a piece of ceramic. And the fidelity we've got is down to about 10 to 15 nanometers. So your hair is about 20,000 microns. You can fit a lot of nanometers in a hair. So we've managed to draw a pattern and get fidelity of the chemistry we wanted right down to basically fine detail. So you think to yourself, well, that's great. Steve's been drawing patterns on ceramics. Wonderful. And people around the world have drawn their university logos. They've written their names. They've said, I love you, to their girlfriends and boyfriends and dogs and everything else. That's not going to change the world. I agree. So what can we do with it? Well, using those same fundamental materials, this is a little paper we published, Joe and Yung-Fei, using those same materials, we started to do some photochemistry. Now, most people don't care about photochemistry, and neither you should, but your clean water that's come from the water treatment plant has been processed using photochemistry. So the same process we're using here produces clean water that we drink. It's a process that is used in developing countries all the time to purify water, to take bacteria out of water, to take dyes out of water, pollutants out of water. So we're using a process which is actually industrial and saves lives. Certainly when you go to disaster zones, you'll find stills where people are using photochemistry to take water and make it potable. So this is not good. Okay, the lines at the top are not great. Lines in the middle are good, but our funky material was better. So we managed to make this little ceramic nanoparticle that when you illuminate it, and it was basically taking a dye out of a solution, so a very common waste stream in countries like Pakistan and Vietnam are dyes. So when they make your clothes, the waste dye just goes down the water stream and pollutes the rivers and kills all the fish and everything, which has disastrous consequences because those populations rely on fish to eat and everything else. So we made this material which can decolorize those dyes really efficiently, really quickly, at very, very low concentrations in the water. So that's pretty cool. We didn't do much more with that, and there's a bit of a manky picture coming up, but a friend of mine in Bath has just got money from one of the water companies in the southwest to basically use that same process to clean their water. So take water that genuinely looks like this, that gets dumped into rivers from various different industrial processes, and clean it using sunlight. So that process is starting to make a bit of a difference and move in and actually transform lives. So it's not something we're doing, but you know, it's a little, we work with him and he's a really cool dude, so it's nice. I said I work with other people, and there's a little thing there from Richard Feynman. So Richard Feynman's a quite a famous physicist, he did nanotechnology. If science is to progress, what we need is the ability to experiment. And the reason that's there is I've just taken some people around to see my labs. They're brilliant, right? I'm so, and ASA has invested heavily in me and the university. And I love to bits the stuff I've got here. I've got an amazing setup and we're doing some really lovely work and we're really making progress. But I can only do so much. So you need to work with other people. And it's not wrong to say that the best work I've done, if you want to score it in terms of quality indexes, has come from working with other people. Because you end up having all of your concepts and ideas challenged. I mean, Hazy, you will know, we'll talk to him on the phone, and he'll constantly challenge my ideas and concepts, and it's absolutely fantastic. Because all it does is mean that you do better science or engineering, because you're not reinforcing your own biases, you're actually coming at it from a new angle. And there's some work there I'm super proud of. I mean, we didn't do all this work. A lot of this work came from working with other people. And that one there, where is it? That one. That's the only paper I've ever published I thought would do that. That took about 18 months to get that paper done. Because the ref, and well, this is where the music's going to come in. So it took about 18 months, but we worked it out. So James and I sat down, and there's a theme to booze, perhaps, which is not necessarily healthy, so don't always use booze. But James and I sat down in a bar in South Kent had a couple of glasses of wine that turned into a bottle of wine, and invented this experiment, and then we did that work, and it got published in AdMap, which I'm super proud of, and it was a really, really good fun project to do. But all this other stuff is just with great people. So Chris is across in Bath, he's brilliant. Ya Chong's in China now, she's in Xi'an. We need to get her to invite me over because I haven't been to Xi'an for a while, which is cool. Hey, Zhu's here today, thank you for coming over. Some brilliant work. I'm going to talk about this later on. This is fundamental physics. I'm a chemist, so it was a real headache for me. But this is just lovely stuff, and I really, really loved it. Right, here comes the music. So, the typical photovoltaics are around about 10 to 15% efficiency. So when you see a photovoltaic on the roof of a house or a garage, they're about 10 to 15% silicon PVs, roughly. Okay? What we did is we made the... You've got to listen to the music, because you'll be up in a moment dancing. There's three bits. I'm going to go behind the camera now. So, orchestra, two cellos coming up. If you ever get a chance to Google, YouTube the two cellos, the less you know, I like these guys. But these guys are brilliant. This is solar cell hell. I hate this. But, give it a moment. So that's Beethoven. That's the two cellos so far. This is where they're moving to. There we go, the proper music. So that's AC/DC. Solar cells really love AC/DC. So do I. So, by playing AC/DC at the solar cells, they got 1.5 times better. Which is quite remarkable, given that I know plenty of researchers who've worked on solar cells for 50 years and they've not made them better at all. They've just stuck at 11% forever. So the question is, and this is where we sent the paper off to the referees, and I got the two of the most disappointing referees' comments ever back. The first one was, can you please play 20 kilohertz at it? And I was like, yes, we can, but why? But then the other referee came back and said, can you play Beethoven or Bach or something like that? So we did, which is why the three different tunes are there. So the point is that Beethoven doesn't have the real thumping. So, who would like to come and do some dancing? Because I was thunderstruck. That's Kate's t-shirt, by the way. So I was thunderstruck, and there's a way to explain. We don't have to do dancing. I can kind of move a bit. But basically, I'm getting the feeling you don't want to dance. I might. Hey, Jean.
No.
Anyway, the point is, we won't play the music again. So if you look at this is the spectrum of the music as it's played. If you look at the Beethoven or the orchestral or the kind of classical music, it looks quite jolty and it looks quite energetic, but actually it lacks the real bass tones. And our music, when we played AC/DC or Persian funk, because Safa, who did this, was a Persian funk fan, and a variety of other different tunes into this solar cell, it got better. Now, the reason is, for exactly the same reason as our systems do really well with the water. So we have a system which is basically functional. I'm gonna need to grab someone, Rachel. Because you're gonna have to hold my... Anita, come on. Yeah. Rachel, Anita, come on.
I'm the only volunteer out of this.
Right, okay. So, now you're going to have to hold hands.
Oh.
No, you're not. Right. This is Rachel. Hello, Rachel. And Anita. Right. So, basically, the solar cell we made was made out of functional materials. So functional materials are functional. When you make them, excite them, like me, excitable, they start to do something interesting. And these particular solar cells are made out of zinc oxide nanomods. So Asa and Rachel are a zinc oxide nanomod.
Okay.
Okay?
Standard very small.
You've got to be tiny down there. Right? But the point is that when they're not moving, there's no charge distribution. They're just still, they're stationary. If they move, they develop a dipole. So develop a dipole for me.
Okay.
Right? Fantastic. On a dipole. Now, the classical music develops a very, very weak, slow dipole, right? So I want a weak, slow dipole.
Weak, slow dipole.
Now, the AC/DC develops a really, really big, powerful dipole.
Okay.
Right, go for it, kick start. Go for it.
I can use my legs as well, possibly.
Okay, right. Now, so we've got a zinc oxide developing a massive dipole. You can stop them entirely.
Okay.
Solar cells, along with lots and lots of things in our world, revolve around stuff being pulled apart. So the physics of a solar cell, which we're not going to go through, is the light hits the solar cell, an electron and a hole are pulled apart, and the internal electric field of the solar cell separates them, and we generate energy by converting solar light into electricity. It's basically photonic pull. So if you just watch the snooker world championships, imagine the photon of light is the cue ball coming down, striking the ball, moves apart. So now, here we have your electrons. So your electrons are going to move apart as a dipole, so move them really fast. Yeah, like, any way you like, doesn't matter. Right? So you move them really fast. Right? Once the electrons are moving really fast under the AC/DC, if I'm a hole and I want to meet an electron, it's really hard for me to grab it. And that's exactly what the music is doing to the solar cell. So the solar cell is vibrating really fast, it's forming a dipole. The electrons and holes, which want to recombine and reduce the overall efficiency of the cell, can't recombine because Asa and Rachel are moving too quickly, and that means that we get an overall enhaced efficiency. Thank you for being solar cells. Very well done. Wonderful. That is actually what we found. Now, we discovered that low impact, low energy vibrations don't give the amount of oscillation. There's a lot of physics behind it, material science. But the high energy stuff was enough to cause the electrons and holes, the electrons real holes are kind of a physics thing. They couldn't recombine, and we saw this really, really good increase in the overall performance of the photovoltaic, which was brilliant, because we didn't really expect it. Again, we just kind of did some science and we had some fun. And we did a load of stuff in the background, so to kind of all bring it all together. So I'm not going to play the music yet. It's AC/DC now. So I was thunderstruck by that, and we've seen these already. And one of the things that really grabbed me by this little piece of work was just how much this idea that music can make a solar cell better grabbed people's attention. I was on I didn't go on the one show because I couldn't go, but I was invited to go on the BBC One show in the evening. We were on the press, I did BBC Click, all sorts of cool stuff, just because the science resonated with a load of people. So we got into the newspapers, we got on the radio, we got on the TV. And I'm not joking, I haven't got the clip anymore because it was a little while ago, but poor old Miley, whatever his name is, Miley Cyrus, she was on LBT, London like Music News in the morning, and the provost of Imperial heard her being interviewed, recorded it, and Gates sent it to James, who's at Imperial, who sent it to me, and he said, she doesn't really understand. And I was like, well, yeah, she didn't. So Miley was good. But it was a really, really lovely thing to do. The science was good. It was hard to get the science to the level that the journal wanted. We had to work really hard for it. We had a lot of fun doing it. There was a lot of, you know, bumming around in the labs and making stuff. And Joe and Safa, so Joe was working with me in my group in QM, and Safa was working with James across at Imperial. They really worked together brilliantly well, and it made a fantastic collaboration, and it got us all sorts of fun things. And the best thing about it was it led to so many adventures. So much fun came on the back of that. We were all, I'd say we, this is me and Yunfei in Changsha. which is a lovely city in sort of central China. That's India, that's near Chennai. So I got a trip to Chennai to go and see the guys and girls there, which is brilliant. That was like a lifetime dream for me, going to see the terracotta soldiers outside Xi'an. If you ever get a chance to go. It is mind-blowing. It is unbelievable. It really is special. And Xi'an is my favourite city in China. It's just a wonderful place. Really, really lovely. This is me getting food. I'll be able to tell you what it is, but it was some grill thing. It was really tasty. Burgers in America. Shanghai. Chris will remember that. And Singapore crab in Singapore. The point is that the stuff you don't see, and this is there's always that iceberg, isn't there, about how life goes, that everything goes on underneath the iceberg and you only see the bit at the top. So the bit at the top is me here now talking to you all, having a really fun time. I'm not nervous anymore. And basically chatting about all the stuff I've done. It's Yung Fei, it's Joe, it's Heiju, it's all these other people, Magda, who's not around, all these other people who have made all this happen through all these lovely relationships and fun times that have enabled me to see all this really cool stuff and have all these amazing memories. The science is hard. You send a journal paper in to the editor and, you know, within 5 minutes, the person's come back saying, oh, we don't like that for my journal. You're like, really? It's not that bad. You send the same proposal to 45 funding agencies and they all come back saying it's utter rubbish. No, it's not. And the worst thing happened to me recently is we sent a paper in about pyro, so using heat to split things and do things. And we had the results, and I was looking at the results. They'd come from Chris in Bath, and Guru and Matt are working on exactly the same thing now. And the referee said, no, it doesn't work. It doesn't work, Stephen. And I was like, what? I've got the results. They're in the proposal. I've said it works. So then I submitted it again. You've obviously got it cracked. I'm like, what? 1 minute it doesn't work, and then I've got it cracked. It's just, you're just always fighting this edge between convincing people it's new and convincing people you can do it. But when you do get funded, celebrate, enjoy it, run the project and have an amazing time. And don't forget that people like Yung Fei and everyone else are the people who will deliver your project for you. They're the people who make it happen. And they're the people who you should, you know, really thank by taking them to Changsha. So, I'm going to talk a bit about science now. I've been told this is the boring bit, so I'm going to try and make it not so boring. So these are the pics of the science I've done. This is the stuff I've really, really loved to do. This is some of the stuff that when we've worked on it and we've published it, you know, there's a sense of pride. I'm fortunate I've published lots of work, but some stuff you publish and you think, well, actually, that's brilliant. I'm really, really pleased with that. And a lot of the time, other people in the community don't agree with you and they never cite it, you know, but don't worry about that. If you're proud of your own work, you're proud of your own work. So this is something I'm really proud of. So we basically, this is working with the team across at Imperial, did a little while ago. What we were doing here is we were trying to show that go back a step. So we do this chemistry with our functional materials. And for about 10 years, referees had been saying to me and the co-authors and other people in this area, you've got a really interesting thing going on there. It's really interesting. You know, you're getting some good results. Everything's more efficient, and we don't doubt your efficiency calculations because they're really easy. You know, they're just simple algorithms. But we don't really trust the underlying physics. We don't really trust what's going on in the background. And we'd like you to work out how it's the physics behind it, the actual fundamentals. And I'm a run-to chemist. So as soon as people say that, I kind of, you know, stick my head under the desk and like get a chemistry textbook out and pretend the physics doesn't exist. But fortunately, I know some people know a bit about physics. So this is an experiment that we did with these guys and girls that effectively proves that some of the stuff I've been very whimsical and wishy-washy about for about 5 or 10 years is real. And it was great because we sent it to the journal. It got published in a really nice journal, AdMats, a really nice place to publish. And it was it got accepted without too many corrections, and it was really nice. But what it shows, this is room temperature, this is high temperature. So we're taking a material which is functional at room temperature, but at high temperatures isn't functional. So above 120 degrees, 130 degrees or so, it goes to being non-functional. So it's always, most of the materials I work with are basically just look a bit like flour. So they're ceramic flour, they're just a boring white powder basically. And at room temperature, it's quite exciting because it does some stuff. But at high temperature, it just collapses and doesn't do anything very interesting. And this is effectively, in fact, the folks that went to the lab saw this. This is a decay curve. So this is the material when it's excited, and this is the material when it's relaxed. So we excite the material to an excited state, and all you need to know is the longer it stays up there, the more chemistry it can do, the more stuff it can do, the more work it can do. So that's the excited state, which is good, and that's the relaxed state, which is not so good. So what we showed is that for beryllium titanate, at room temperature, the excited state is about 0.2 of a second. For pretty much every material that you would measure, the excited state would be maybe a millisecond. So this is like sort of 10 or 100,000 times longer in terms of excited states. You have 100,000 times more time to do chemistry. And that explains why ferroelectrics function materials do the photochemistry they do. And that was dead chuffed. Because when you've been asked a question, you genuinely don't know the answer, and you've got all these kind of gut feelings, and you get the answer, it's really, really, really wonderful. So that was cool. I was really pleased about that. There's another paper coming up now, which is with AG. Another question they kept asking us, which really nicked my head, was if you have a ceramic, if you have a ferroelectric, so you can see these are here, they're tiny, they're like 50 nanometers or so, and this is with Chester and QM and a few other people around the world, another really nice collaborative piece of work. So you can see these are tiny, these are 50 nanometers. So pair, sort of microns, nanometers, way tiny. So you could fit, I don't know, maybe 10,000 of those particles across your hair. They're pretty tiny. But the important thing about them is they're just a single lump. There's no lines in them, there's no grains in them, they're just a single lump. So this is a single lump and that's a single lump. And what we've been asked for many, many, many years was if we had a powder that had a line through the middle of it, if it had a domain wall, is what the line would be called, if it had a domain wall, is the domain wall doing all the work for us? And again, I would get on to my... You know, you get the referee's report, the first thing you do is you write, "Dear editor, please leave me alone." And then you think, well, that's not the right thing to say. So, "Dear editor, we can't do that work because we don't have the right spectroscopy, blah, blah, blah." And they come back saying, "Well, okay, we'll let you go away this time, but, you know, maybe you should think about the future and get published." So this is the work we did that shows that actually the domain wall is not part of the process. It is just the fact this material has a dipole. It's the fact that we had Rachel and Asa doing their arms, wiggling around. We didn't have to cut them in half and put a wall at the middle of them. Their arms wiggling around was all it took for the separation of the excited carriers. Now, another way to think about it is, if I was, don't do it because easy to flip up, but with the students, what I often get them to do is ask them to jump up out of their seats. If you jump up out of your seats, you're going to come straight back down. There's been no net change in where you are. There's no energy change. You've gone up and come down. And that's exactly the same thing that could happen if there were no walls here. But actually, what we found without walls is if I ask you to jump up and all move the seat to the left, there's been an energy change. So that's what happens without the walls. By exciting the species up, it drifts away and you get some work done. You can actually do some chemistry. You can do your water splitting. You can do all those funky things that enable us to do something interesting with our materials. So the most recent stuff we've done, I say stuff a lot, most recent work we've done is to use vibrations to do chemistry, to split water. Now, this is the work that we got told by the referees wouldn't work, and we've now published three papers on it, so grr. But nonetheless, what we've done is we've shown that you can take a powder, you can vibrate it, shake it around, jiggle it, and it will do chemistry. Now, the latest stuff published on this is absolutely brilliant because a group in Germany have taken the same powder we've been using and have started to kill MRSA and other bacteria by basically putting it in a vessel, shaking the vessel with this. The bacteria get denatured, the proteins in the bacteria die, and the protein actually is no longer capable of causing an infection just by vibrating it. And that's really quite interesting because the world is a very shaky place. I got the train in today, it's very shaky. So here's a thought experiment. You take your shaky train, you put some of this powder in the roof of the train, in a water solution, just water, and as the train is jiggling along, the water gets split into hydrogen and oxygen, and you can form a fuel to power the train by using the energy from the train. The plus from that is, If you're taking the energy out to do chemistry for you, you're absorbing some of the vibration, the train journey should get a bit smoother. So you can use this to do scavenge waste heat, to scavenge energy, to scavenge vibration, to do something useful. And that's where we're trying to go with this. That's the work that we're working on now. Not necessarily vibration, but we're also using like the thermal fluctuations. And I think that's, again, I find it really fascinating. We're doing a little bit of work on this, but it's being picked up in groups around the world who are trying to do this. And this is with Fong, who just, she think I'm crazy. I've only ever met her on Teams, and she like bounces down the cable at me. But I'm delighted that we got a little Royal Society grant, and she's going to get to come and visit London for a month next summer. So it'll be really wonderful. So this, these little papers that you're getting, again, it's people that they're going to come over and visit. And I'm over the moon. I'm going to get to go to Vietnam because I can't wait to have some summer rolls in Vietnam. So I'm really looking to go over for a couple of weeks and just do some science. And her, she's got her lab is actually in her house. So during COVID, they shut the university. She just moved all of the lab into her house. So it's just, you're on Teams calls. You're like, oh, I've just got the sample in the kitchen. And she'll run away and she'll come back with a sample and go, what's that look like? I'm like, yeah, it looks all right. And it's just, yeah, and she's there with the two kids running around and her husband going crazy in the house, and they're doing science, and it's just brilliant. So this is, again, the work that we did. So this is barium titanate. It's just a very interesting archetypal material. We use it all the time because it's cheap and easy and safe. But the trick here is that top left corner is where you want to be. So that is basically a scale of energy, or available energy, energy that we're able to use to do something, and that is a loading dose. So that is basically putting less of the material in. So effectively, by putting less of the material in, we're getting more out. So that's a win-win in terms of energetics. So very little amount of material goes in, and we get more stuff out. And what we did with that was we split water. So taking H2O and forming hydrogen and oxygen, which is quite useful because hydrogen is a pretty good fuel. I don't know if it's necessarily the fuel of the future, but it's certainly a very good fuel. So basically a cocktail shaker, and we get hydrogen out at the other end. And this does work. We spent a long time trying to work out, does it genuinely work? But it really does genuinely work. The other thing that we've done is to use this thermal fluctuation. So you can use heat in all sorts of ways. Now the world, as we saw earlier on with the Carnot equation, the world is basically a hot and cold place. We use the difference between hot and cold to generate all sorts of stuff. And heat, waste heat, breaks down into two broad silos. The first silo is waste heat over 100 degrees. So any heat over 100 degrees C can be used to generate steam. And that is what they call high quality. It's typically high quality or high value heat. So as soon as you can produce steam, you can spin up a turbine and you can produce electricity really quite efficiently. Heat under 100 degrees C is low grade, low value, because you can't generate steam, so you can't spin a turbine, so you can't do so much really fun stuff with it. Unless you're me and my friends. Because what we can do is we can take that oscillation of low grade, low value heat and split water. And we can split water to form hydrogen just by taking a ceramic and fluctuating the temperature. Now, because of the way the ceramic works, the fluctuation can be really quite tiny. So, looking around in here, can't see what... So when you go home and you look at... or you go into a building and you see a little white box in the corner of the room that is either a smoke detector or a burglar alarm, that has the same material in it. And that material is so sensitive to a change in temperature that in a room this big, if a mouse walked in, it could detect it. So the heat radiated from a mouse, about 1 to the minus 7 Kelvin, can be detected by a pyroelectric sensor. So they're dialed down a bit for fire detectors and intruder alarms, but they're incredibly sensitive. So turning that thing around and generating work from it means you can actually get quite a lot of work out of a pyroelectric element. And that's what we're doing there, we're splitting water. But that's not the end of it. That's not where I want to see it go. Where we want to take it is we want to do the chemistry on carbon dioxide. So splitting water is actually relatively easy. You need about 1.5 volts between two, we can set it up here between two 1.5 volt battery, two pencils, stick it into water, oxygen off one side, hydrogen off the other side, pretty straightforward. This isn't sparkling water, but if it was sparkling water, it'd be carbon dioxide in the water. What we want to do, and this is Guru's project, and Matt's helping in the lab with that, is to take carbon dioxide and convert it into a really high-value fuel, so methane, so CH4. So take CO2, turn it into methane or formic acid or formaldehyde, and then we get that using waste heat to form a fuel, and actually the overall life cycle analysis and efficiency of the system is really quite positive. So that's what we're trying to do, and I think that's what we can do. On a Tuesday I'm second-guessing myself, on a Wednesday I think it's all dead easy, and by Thursday I'm second-guessing myself again, but I think we can do it. The physics is there, the chemistry is there, and I think we can do it. So that's what we're trying to do. So we've done loads. There's still lots and lots and lots of stuff. Now I was talking to a mum on the way here today, I'm getting really concerned about the world and where it's going to be for kids. I think we've partied hard as a generation, and we're not necessarily leaving the world in a great place for those coming along. So we need to be thinking quite a bit about how we can provide sustainable and renewables and be green, not necessarily Kermit. So we've got loads of ideas still. There's loads and loads of science I'd like to do, and there's loads of stuff we're going to be doing forward. And I can't wait for that next transformational moment. I think in my career, sort of getting towards a little bit towards the end of the talk, but in my career there's been maybe 4 or 5 moments where stuff has really clicked. And they say you don't have that many ideas, and I completely agree. So the first one was at Cranfield, when my boss at the time, Roger Watmore, and if you know Roger, he is an incredibly clever guy. And he sat down and he said, you know, the best thing I learned in life was you're always, always someone's more clever than you. So don't think you're the cleverest person in the room, because you never are. It's just fact. So, okay, that's cool. That makes sense. You're certainly cleverer than me, so that's okay. And that was a moment where we started to do some really interesting science, because it became really challenging and actually quite difficult for me to do it. The other time was when I had some ideas and I was surrounded by people who could help me come to fruition. So, you know, the worst thing in the world is if you've got ideas to do stuff and there's no one there to help you, you're just sort of, you know, banging your head against the wall. So having that network of friends and collaborators and people you can chat to really made a difference, and that was a big change. Tara touched on me going into industry. That was hilariously brilliant. I learned more in a small time in industry about everything in life, including how to work with a very interesting line manager. That was just brilliant. But also, you know, being line managing a team of people for the first time, a big team, having a big budget for the first time, all those kind of things, you learn how to deal with it because there's huge expectations. And it was really good fun. It was a fantastic experience. And if you ever get a chance to do a sabbatical in industry, take it. You know, go to Acer and make the case about or your dean or the provost. Make the case as to why going to industry will be good for you, and come back to university full of new ideas and full of new ways to do things, because it is transformational. It was an amazing experience. I loved it to bits. And I still have great fun with the guys when I go over to Wales. And in fact, a couple of weeks ago, they were over in London and we had a few glasses, straight bottles of wine on the river. And it was really good fun and it made a big, big difference. So that was maybe the third time. The fourth time was actually, kind of not chronological, was when I was made a lecturer. And I had a moment where I was interviewed, and then Roger, who was my boss at the time, came over and said, well, you know, you've got the job. I'm like, straight. And he said, now the hard work starts. And I sort of sat there because I thought I was going to go home and have a bottle of champagne. And thought, well, maybe I won't just yet. But anyway, you celebrate these things. But he was absolutely right, in the hard work starts. But actually, everything you've seen so far, all of the fun, all of the excitement, all the fact that I am genuinely love the science I do, and I love the environment I do it in. And it's just so much great stuff and excitement, as well as like heartache. But it's just that opportunity to do your own thing. You can do it. And the best thing about working in a university as a member of academic staff is you've got a full-time job, but you can do what you like, broadly. I mean, you have to do your teaching and stuff, and anyone here who is in chem knows you have to do your teaching and stuff. But if you want to do research on protein denaturing, do it. If you want to do research on, I don't know, fossil teeth and whether or not they're stronger than limpet teeth, Acer, go and do it. Just enjoy it. You can do what you like. You have the freedom to express yourself and have fun. And there's no other job I can think of in the world that lets you do that. especially when you're in industry, your boss says, right, today we're doing this, and you're like, that's a bad idea. No, we're doing it anyway. But so you don't have that. You know, you've got to do your teaching, you've got to do your admin, you've got to sort all those things out, but everything else is down to you. So, some take-home messages, because we are winding up. And SpongeBob, it's fun. Right, and don't for a second think it's not, because it is. There are times when it's horrible. I know an email from me saying, can you do your NSS or whatever else, you know, exam marking, all those kind of things. But actually, the opportunity to do what you want and express yourself is unique. And while the job itself is hard and there are lots of things that we don't want to do, actually, I've had just some of the most amazing times and seen some of the most brilliant stuff, and everyone else should embrace the opportunity. This is Sheldon Cooper. Life is not the Big Bang Theory. It really isn't. And unlike Sheldon Cooper, who may be the cleverest person in the room, remember you're not. There will always be someone who can add value to the conversation. There will always be someone who knows something more than you, who knows how to do something, has experienced something, can take you aside and say, stop being an idiot. Listen to people, they're really important. And baby steps. My career was a series of little steps and then huge jumps. So I remember, and so I've been with Rachel Rewild, and you know, when I was trying to get my chair at QM for the first, you know, trying to move up into that, was working ridiculous amounts of hours to try and do something. And move forward. And it's those baby steps. It's not taking rejection personally. It's not writing to the editor of Journal ABC saying, hello. It's about gently just nurturing yourself into the world of academia. It's about letting people know you're there. I mean, you know, just express yourself and use those baby steps. Use those small integral forward motion to get somewhere really special. Right. Don't know if this will load. I touched on this before, and I'll labour the point because it's really important. These people are brilliant. These people are the people who have made so much happen for me as an individual. This is Nimra with a prize. This is Hengi, who's in Singapore. Heiju here, Magda, Leonard. Loads and loads of people on there. A lot of these people I still talk to, and we still chat with, and we still do research together. A lot of these people I haven't seen for 2 or 3 years because of COVID. In fact, where is it? Chris, saw Chris last week for the first time in 3 years at a conference, the IOP. Unfortunately, his wife was there, so we weren't allowed to go for a beer. She dragged him away, because apparently I'm a bad influence, which I don't believe for a second. These are great. And I put this here, so this is Pim, who was a really good friend of mine, who unfortunately died of COVID a couple of years ago. And I was really touched to give his memorial lecture at the American Ceramic Society meeting the end of last year. So that was us in Virginia at not having any beers. So there are some people who make it work now. Matt and Guru in the lab, thank you for everything you do. I genuinely couldn't do it without you. I have quite a busy life. People might not think it's true, but I do generally, and they keep it all working day to day, so thank you so much. Guru, you're going to do a great PhD. I'm really proud of you. Swela, Fatima and Kate do loads and loads and loads to help me. Fatima basically makes the division work. Anyone who thinks I do it doesn't know me very much. So Swela helps in loads of ways with stuff in the lab and research. And Kate basically takes me out and gets me drunk when I've had too much. So brilliant to have them around and look after me. Life is a roller coaster. And there are two people now, but there were three people who made me get through the roller coaster. One is Rachel, who you've seen doing the shaky arms, delivering gins at Christmas, and my mum and dad, who, unfortunately, my dad can't be here today, which is a real shame, because I think he would have had a good time too. So I am going to finish with my usual slide, but I don't know if you do questions at the end of the walk. Well, I won't do that then. I'll just say thank you very much for listening, and thanks for coming. I really appreciate it.
Thanks very much, Steve. I'm Asa Barber. I'm Dean of the School of Engineering. I think actually the first thing I'd like to say, having done a few of these inaugural lectures, it seems that people in the School of Engineering are very hungry because they spend a disproportionate amount of time talking about food. So it's nice to see that we're kind of continuing that tradition. And I think, yeah, you spoke about these takeaway messages. So it's always nice to get the individual's perspective on how they've progressed to this point within their career. And I think what's nice that came through is it's not just having those ideas. I think you kind of pushed down the idea that they're clever ideas, but I think they were exceptional ideas. But I think what it was nice to see as well is how the people that you worked with had progressed. And I think the impact that you made internationally with so many different people and entities really around the planet. So I thought that was really, really great. Obviously the outcomes were very strong. Tara, you spoke about the metrics, but I think, you know, those publications are really competitive to get into. And I think the real volume and breadth of where you were able to output your ideas and your work was really, really exceptional. And of course, I think the direction in sustainability and green technologies is something that's becoming an increasing societal need with things like national strategies or international strategies in net carbon zero. So I think it really, you know, while you reflected back on your work, I think that's very much the next, obviously, 10 to 20 years. It's only going to become increasingly more important. But I think the real takeaway message was about the kind of the other stuff. And that's the, I would say, you know, how you've been able to create relationships with people, the right environment, the right culture in which people can work well and really become high achievers within this particular discipline. So I think that came really strongly, that environment and culture, how you have been consistently able to do that at a bunch of different organisations. So really, I'd like to thank you, Steve, for your really entertaining inaugural lecture. Well done for trying to make me look silly, making me work hard. I thought I could sit there having a nice evening, but no, you got me up there. I'm sure it's not going to be on the internet or anything like that. So yeah, too late. That's right. So the tradition is, there's no questions, but I'd encourage you all to stay behind. We have refreshments just at the back. But also, as a tradition, we have a memento to celebrate this. I think we'll take a picture and also invite you all to congratulate Steve again on his achievement.